of secure, you know, in her way, because I think the righteous woman get maligned with the, you know, with the unrighteous woman, because there might be a, sometime undue silence, just like the same way that righteous men get maligned with the unrighteous man if they see the unrighteous man action and they don't check that, or they don't say, yo, that's, you know what I mean? At least testify against, to show that, because it says silence implies consent.
Yeah.
You know, if I say you were a fool and you just be quiet, well, everybody who's with me will say, well, I guess he's right. You know what I mean? But if you say no, you know, you respond to that, then, oh no, he said that, but not, nah, it can't be, you know, so and so said such and such. So it becomes now, it's not left to a one wrong voice speaking and giving, you know what I mean? But anyway, it's
Isaiah. The representation of folly is the ones have to separate, like, you know, and like when Moshe said, you know, who's with me, and the Levite separated, you know, and then after that, everything else was a wrap, you know. And actually, speaking of that, Brother Alonso did want to say a word on that, and pertaining to Ham and the Queen of Sheba, I believe. Brother Alonso, are you on the line at all? Are you available? Well, I think it's related to the Queen of Sheba. Yes, I. You're on, Brother.
All right, Shalom. Shalom, Wyndham.
Shalom. Wyndham.
You know, just from what the whole Queen situation. I mean, this is a very, like, a, I guess, like, a very simple way to look at it, but I think the way to complete and justify how Zawditu was reigning, being a queen, even though, you know, Makeda had said, as she said, is basically because she was sustained in that the image and likeness of the Word was being that comforter to her position. So her reign is not necessarily like just like of a queen. What I'm trying to get to is the book of, let's see, Genesis, chapter 1. Let's see, I think it's verse 26, if I'm not mistaken. Or no. I'm looking for that word.
You get kind of. Yes, this is
in the image of
And one moment, I just would like to say I'm gonna call him again, and just to make sure my mic will not be muted or Wyndham yet, and I would like to speak on the reasoning with the co-cab, the brethren, on that reasoning. Go forward, Wyndham.
All right, I called in open time.
Real briefly, what I'm trying to say is that basically it's like we can't divide the power of the Trinity. So it's basically saying it's verse 27. So God created man in his own image, in the image of God created he him. So that's a mere image of itself. That's a true and faithful witness. That's like saying devarim, words. One word confirms the other. It's a mere image. It's a perfection. It is what it is. And it goes on to say, male and female created he them. And so just like the composition of an individual male has to be female and male. There has to be a health in that soul that there's so many ways to go about it, but there's got to be a balance within an individual self. And so Zawditu, she's really being sustained by the fact that the Word is made manifest to the image and likeness. As far as that, the prophecy of the spirit of prophecy according to that present revelation of that time. So it was still, the Word was still manifesting, but still, it's like, that's kind of like a point aside. But I did want to mention, just briefly, because of judgment. All right. If I'm not mistaken, that Shabbat study would have been on where we have the Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Echad, correct? The last Shabbat study. So basically, consequently to what? To the name, to the authority, there's an image and a likeness that you have to be a likened to. You have to be one with. You have to walk with, in companionship. and, you know, be sustained in that companionship, which is the word. So it must be loved with all the soul, heart, strength, and all that. And that leads us to consequently, you know, if you find a likeness, then you have a male ruler, you have a female ruler, you have you have the complete Trinity. But what I was trying to go to with judgment is that Sheba was interested, or Makeda, she was interested in the name, in the authority, in the Shem. She was after the Achadu, the oneness. So judgment is not necessarily condemnation from her behalf. It's her action that kind of, and our inactivity that kind of like manifests our own judgment. She was willing to travel long distances. People probably died in that travel because it wasn't like taking a plane and stuff like that. So the investment that she put towards the spirit of truth, after just being, you know, driven left and right by winds of doctrine, she decided that even though she didn't believe half of the story that she was told, when she went to go figure it out for herself and she seen it with her own eyes, she realized that not even half of the glory of Solomon had been told her. But she was at, that's judgment. And the condemnation is in those that have the power to log in to their iPhones and stuff like that and just check it out. But the interest is the inactivity. There's no interest. There's no wisdom in a person that cannot take advantage of the technology, which is the revelation of itself. The artistry of his word, the tech, how he is the tech or the technician over his logos, the tech logo or technology, right? So it's an expression of the self so that it can recognize itself to be, to maintain the world being. And so ones have the power to kind of just check it out. Research how he saw you first, do a little bit of study. This is how the word has been revealed in these days. And so because we lack the interest, or even, I mean, we could do that from the comfort of our couches, right? So this judgment of going out and seeking the truth. Now, the judgment is very, 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 it's very delicate. Jesus Christos manifested love, and he fulfills Torah. That means that any judgment based on Torah that leads to condemnation, which is not of love, is not Torah. It's not kosher. It's not a right interpretation of the words that agree with the image and likeness of himself. So we have to cancel a judgmental, a prejudice mindset, and which takes us to Ham. What's wrong with Ham? What's wrong with Ham is that the power of word, Devarim. Noach, he is the Sadiq of Sadiqs. You know, he's the righteous man that propelled some kind of salvation into a new world order. And he is slipping. So when he said, "Cursed be Canaan," you know, "Blessed be Jah," that he actually put prophetical words in his mouth, and that Canaan did his own sin to deserve that prophetical, cursing. But Ham has always taken the rap for this because the power of words, because he was associated with Canaan. Canaan, see, Torah tells you that you cannot, a father will not pay for the sin of the son, and the son will not pay for the sin of the father. Ham is innocent. Canaan went forward and he did his own thing, which eventually kind of like, it made this equilibrium with what Noah had said. So I could see like relief in Noah and be like, oh, okay, like I didn't really mess up. Canaan was kind of prophetically already headed towards that direction. But what's the difference between Ham and Adam? How come we don't say, oh, Adam, father of Cain? It's the power of words. It's that a very righteous man, he was slipping, he got caught up. Ham testifies to the inaccuracies or misinterpretations that have gone within the tabernacle, as it does now, but it's mixed with Shem. But still, it's still like a prophetic view into how we don't want to see the shame within the self. And that's the judgment. Mm-hmm. That if we see the shame in the self, then we would want to rightly trace or visualize upon others good thoughts. Because my expression of truth is how I have lived it is stained by error. So I want to see perfection in others, that by maybe doing that, then grace and mercy shall be applied on me, and that ones will see lightly through my, you know, shortcomings. And what I'm saying is that Ham, all he did was go out and say and testify to the nakedness of his father. His father was slipping, and Ham is the youngest. Consider this. He's the youngest. So that means that he's got two brothers that are above him in age that should be taking responsibility for the youngest. So he comes out of Ethiopia and just kind of reveals, whether knowingly or unknowingly, but he reveals what's going on inside. I don't know if I don't know if the, like right now, Ethiopia, if you want to associate it with Ham, and there's nothing wrong with that, because Ham will in a righteous judgment, you realize that Ham really is like he's been
So we're going into this debate with these so-called Hebrews, and though the sons of Ham, what's wrong with Ham?
Adam had a child named Cain. Why is he not stained with the bad reputation for having Cain when Ham, all he did was father Canaan? But the mistakes of the children are the mistakes of the children, and the father shall not pay for them. But in the case of Ham, that's judgment. That's the queen of the south. Even though she is connected to both Ham and Shem, it's the fact that, are you willing to go forward and seek righteous judgment according to his word revealed in his image and likeness? Instead of going forward with these presupposed, already developed concepts of what is inevitably a misinterpretation, because Torah does not condemn, really. Because if Jesus Christus lives and fulfills every word, every piece of a word of Torah, then Torah is love, and that's what we must see in it. So if we see the likeness and image, our judgment will be just graceful and merciful. And then we don't have to be condemned by the prior or previous errors of our Jacob walk, because then we would have been well-rounded and perfected, refined to a spiritual being that can no longer be attributed to the mistakes that the natural man came about. And so you don't, instead of bringing forth punishment and rigorous judgment, you know, you're in the heights, you're in the heaven, and because of your ability to judge righteous judgment, then you know, it's kind of like one is above the whole karmatic effects of karmatic laws of law and effect and stuff like that. In a sense, you're not judged as rigorously as or meticulously as we would be under a law that condemns us to death, but rather we're covered, and so our own righteous judgment kind of is reflected upon ourselves. And so love thy neighbor as thyself, kind of like that. And so the reason I brought that whole thing up is because Ham has a really bad reputation. And Ham did not make the mistakes that his son did. And he should not be accredited to them, just like Adam is not accredited with fathering Cain, in the sense that Cain did what he did. But even in Cain did something that was unknown at those times. He murdered. Cain isn't necessarily as guilty as we would make him out to be. Does he still have to pay the consequences of his actions? Well, yes. But it's our judgment. It's the way that we judge. We judge unfairly.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Queen of the South, and she judged according to... She was after the Spirit of Truth. That's what she was after. And that's a righteous judgment. You know, just seeking his word.
Mm-hmm.
And now those that can't seek today are condemned. In that she traveled, you know, space-time and did what she did, put down some money, a lot of it, you know, brought some gifts, and insured herself to be of a good lineage. Like I think I heard one of the sisters reading Psalm 16. I'm not sure, but you know, I think it kind of mentioned of a lineage, you know, being of a righteous lineage, so of a just from a just people, you know. So I just kind of felt that that's necessary, because we really got to re-examine this Ham situation, because there's nothing wrong with Ham. And then on top of that, it's Ham. If he's a servant, that's not bad. It's bad when it's unconscious and it's not being directed towards a positive outcome. But all things are positive because the Creator works it that way. But that's a whole different story, but and a different level of perspective in which one's got to see things and see the blessing and the good in all things. Because if we see bad, then we're still eating from a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And so even though a situation may appear to be a little bit, you know, like just challenging, even just to comprehend what's going on, know that you don't got to comprehend. You've got to have faith that Jah's in control. That's what it is. And He would not, that is people be forsaken, and that His word be made, you know, be made of none effect. So we have that comfort, you know. But, you know, I'm just kind of going off at this point, so just kind of wanted to share the whole judgment thing, the way we see things. We really gotta not go at it with a prejudiced mindset, and really look for the fullness of it. Look for grace. Look for love. Be able to find love through the Torah, which is fairly easy once you receive Christ, because then if He's love, then every time Torah speaks about death, then you have to think life. How does this scripture bring forth life? And then the law would have been fulfilled, and that the law would not have been kept so much, but it would have been guarded. So then we would be not judges of the law. We would be in the law, you know, but a superior law. So, you know, just kind of putting that out there.
Thanks, Regin, and yeah, for a lot of.
I mean, yeah, I have some questions, because I'm pretty sure there's a lot of like little details that kind of have to go studied in. But I just kind of brought forth like just like a brief summary of like some of the details that, okay, when ones take careful care to set time aside, you know, bring out the notebooks and the study books and all that, then ones could have like just like an outline of some of the things to kind of look out for, you know.
Yes, okay.
Like for example, I just got to say this. Noah was slipping since before the ark. He wasn't fully faithful, but he was faithful enough to the point where he said he built an ark. So when he was told, like, hey, go into the ark, because 7 days from now I'm gonna cause it to rain, something that had never happened in my opinion, you know, just kind of like going into how it could have been, how the atmosphere could have been way different before Ham, Shem, and Japheth, when the split was made. And then, you know, this whole pigmentation, you know, transformation could have, you know, that there's a possibility in that had to do with it, because rain brings in a whole different, like, cycle. And so it brings in, like, these constant seasons. And so that creates, like, for fixed, you know, like, different fixed seasons with very well-defined temperatures, you know, attached to them. And which can create differences depending on your position on the earth. It could create differences in the pigmentation in one's skin, hair, and all that kind of stuff. So just putting that out there. But what I was trying to say is that we really got to...
Noah.
Not to condemn Noah.
But he went into the ark.
When they saw the floods of the water come down. So, but Jah is not going to, you know, to blaspheme His own name and discrediting His own righteous people. But this is not to condemn, no. It's only to see that there's more that when we really pay close attention, we see that Ham is basically inheriting the tragedy of Noah's time. He was slipping already, and so it wasn't until they saw the waters of the flood that they ran into the ark. But the good thing and what saved Noah is that he had faith enough to build an ark to run into.
Yes, amen.
So that makes all the difference, you know, because if he would not have listened to the first step, just build yourself an ark. And then Jah said, all right, 7 days from now, go inside, because 7 days from now, he didn't go inside. But when he saw the waters, he had somewhere, he had sanctuary. He had a place of refuge, just like Cain was given a place of refuge, because Jah exercises the ability to forgive and to show grace and mercy, which are heavenly powers that are far superior than all the weaknesses that we are taught in the world, the fear, violence, you know, hostility, and discrimination, and all these kind of things that are actually, like, weaker in the ultimate judgment of creation. When one judges with clemency, with compassion, with as much love, but, you know, tough love is necessary to bring forth repentance, proven by the acts of one changing their mind and being tough on the situations that need to be tough on. So that kind of true and pure love, you know, to His image and likeness, brings forth a light heart, you know, it brings forth a peaceful life upon earth and sustains that, you know, the just cause and faith, you know, David will still be Goliath. And so we have that comfort on top of it, you know, because we become one with him that is one, because we are one, we are in likeness. And so we don't watch events happen, we form them. Because we have that strength in the heights of the mentality, and that this is, see, the problems that we're confronted with in the flesh, we attack the flesh and we make the problem worse, because it's a spiritual disconnect.
Yes.
It's a spiritual disconnect that one has to tap into the heights at that very moment and see, what is it that I have to learn from this moment? This is what I live for. This is what I was born for. To be crucified at this minute, but there's something that I got to overcome. There's something I got to learn. See, this person right here that's giving me an attitude, he might have had a very bad day. His daughter could have died for all I know. So why am I going to push this agenda like of a hostility upon this innocent, yes, seemingly innocent person? I could judge, say like, hey, why are you screaming at me? Well, my daughter just died. Is that good enough? You know? Then you're going to feel kind of guilty for even, you know, oh, I had no idea. Well, that's the thing. We don't have any idea, so we can't jump to conclusions.
Yes,
so when you start living a life like this, you can start forming events before they happen, because you're basically sustained in the integrity that you're ruling in Christ.
Yes,
and without Christ, nothing can be done. So it's like you either in Christ and it comes to pass, or you know, you missed the mark.
Yes, sir. Give thanks, Lyndon Alfonso.
That's a lot of good word sound power, you know, coming from the eye, and just the understanding of the female